if this radio station took off, it was going to be very popular.
Radio Hauraki takes its name from the slice of the Hauraki Gulf that's set outside the 3-mile limit, making it international water. The one place some rock and roll rebels could legally broadcast the music that New Zealand teens wanted to hear. In the 60s, radio was king. And while the Beatles, Rolling Stones and Beach Boys rocked the charts overseas, state-run NZBC was a little behind the times.
We are now in our 53rd year of broadcasting.
Good evening, girls and boys. It is so nice to be with you again.
So, kia ora, cheerio, everybody.
But four guys from Auckland had a plan to change all that. Buying a boat and starting New Zealand's first commercial radio station offshore. Initially planned as just a stunt to pressure the government to grant them a license to broadcast on land, their stint at sea would see them riding the waves for 3 years. In that time, they weathered some of the worst storms in New Zealand's history, risked financial ruin, the lives of their crew, and more than just a few times, literally landed on the rocks. With the government doing everything they could to stop the ship from sailing, late on the 24th of October 1966, the team made a daring break for it out of Auckland Harbour.
We were broke and we'd had enough, and we decided to go that night.
The prospect of seeing a pirate ship set sail under the noses of the cops and everything drew a lot of people to the viaduct.
So then we stormed under the bridge, but by this stage, the guy in charge of the bridge was lowering it. And we got stuck under the bridge. All the policemen jumped on board, and we're having this sort of stoush on board. I mean, there were punches being thrown, and there was a lot of emotions running very high.
That was when Peter Telling and Ian McGann and Colin Broadley rushed around and wedged themselves under the bridge so that it couldn't be lowered any further.
So we rushed around the other side of the viaduct and sat under the bridge. One of us, Peter Telling, stuck his head under the very cogs that allowed the bridge to go up and down.
And years later, I met the old guy who was in the drawbridge, and he said, "Listen, sonny, I've got to tell you." He said, "You wouldn't have got under that bloody bridge if you knew the condition of the brakes."
We steamed out into the harbour, but by then, platoons of police had come on board.
But by then, the police had managed to break down the door of the wheelhouse, overpower the crew, and shut down the motors. So that was the end of that. We were under arrest.
After rallying together a protest and successfully navigating through the courts, they quietly took the boat out to sea this time. It was a stealthy start to a sound sensation, and they soon found that their giant radio mast could stretch their scratchy signal all the way to the South Island at night. Though they may have been winning over the hearts of the nation, the sea gave them a battering. On the 28th of January 1968, the Titty ran aground on Great Barrier Island, wrecking the ship. By April, their second ship, the Titty 2, would be beached at Whangaparapara Harbour, but this time saved to sail once again, only to end up stuck on the rocks just 2 months later.
Abandon ship.
After 111 days at sea, the government finally granted them a license to broadcast on land. Their final weekend broadcasting at sea was tinged with sadness, however, when announcer Rick Grant fell overboard and was never found.
A wave seemed to hit the side of the ship and lurch the whole ship sideways, and Rick must have lost his balance and just gone overboard. He had a torch with him, and the torch stayed on, and we could hear him yelling. By this, Chris raised the alarm, we all came out to the side deck and could see Rick aft of the ship. So we went straight into action and tried to turn the ship around get it back to where it was. Of course, with a tailwind and heavy seas, it was extremely difficult to do. We finally got it around, but by that time, there was no sign of Rick.
Now into its sixth decade, Radio Hauraki has become a nationwide radio station that's truly made waves and broken barriers in broadcasting history.